Yes, hello and welcome to my talk, Design Systems Engineering and Scaling User Interfaces. I start with that picture, that's me at work, no kidding. You might know this famous historic picture. She is currently repairing a tire of a plane while it's flying. And this is how I felt very often the last 5 years. This picture and my talk have something in common. Both are based on a true story. Before I start with my talk about our journey with introducing, implementing, concepting, and rolling out a design system, I would like to first introduce you a bit into that topic. This graphic by Nate Baldwin tries to visualize a bit what's behind a design system. In general, design systems have an impact on the whole organization, not only on its development teams. Nevertheless, in my talk, I will concentrate on the engineering sides of design systems. So you can see it's about components, style guide, process, UI layer, assets, and then the more design parts, design principles, design language, and UI toolkit. Yes. Let's start with a few definitions first, which I will use throughout my talk. The first one is a CSS framework. You might know what this is about, but nevertheless, it's a production-ready front-end code, which should be modular, scalable, and in the best case, it can also be very easily integrated into a continuous integration environment. As an example, this is the CSS framework from Scooter, Dropbox from Scooter. The next definition is the style guide. As a design system, it's purely assets and code. You need something to demonstrate how the UI patterns work, with some references, with some help, how to use them, and when to use them. That's what we call a style guide. Again, a Scooter from Dropbox. Here are some components described and additional information. If you would scroll down, you would also see some already how it would look like and the representation of that pattern. A pattern library is, for us at Trivago, the repository which we use to share the assets, and it's also, at the end, the repository where we build our UI from. The design system itself is then the entirety of all this stuff, so it also includes the processes, it also includes the people involved, and it's basically the ecosystem which drives the unification of products. Let's have a look on some popular design systems first, which are out there. I'm pretty sure most of you know Google Material Design. I think I don't have to tell you so much about that, which is a very complex and works on all devices. I think Google did a quite good job, and I think it was also one of the first ones. I personally also like the Lightning design system from Salesforce. It is very good documented and also inspires me and inspired us a lot at Trivago. VMware has recently launched their Clarity design system, and Shopify did the same with the Polaris design system, which they have, I think, released 1 month ago. So, but why do we actually need a design system? As said, I will not talk so much about the parts which don't affect code. I think it's pretty obvious that the design system has a positive impact on your branding, on your corporate identity, but that's not what I would like to talk about today. So I would like to give you some reasons why we thought that's something we should also have a deeper look into. As first, the more consistent your design is, the more consistent your code will be. And we wanted to remove a bit of clutter in code and design, which I will show you later what happened with our code base. And with that, of course, we wanted to improve code maintainability and reduce technical debt. Of course, all that leads to then also to a better maintainability of the application. And we became really, really slow 2 years ago in 2015. So we needed to rethink how we can create a sustainable base to actually scale our products better and also faster. Let's go back to 2012 when I actually joined Trivago. This is the specificity graph of the CSS base. I have never seen something like that before, and they basically hired me to fix that. The maximum specificity here is 412, and CSS was never invented to draw skylines with those graphs. But that happened. The code behind that looked a bit like that. I don't know how many of you write CSS, but if you once write CSS, never do it like this. It was very, very heavily nested inside SCSS, which we use as a preprocessor. And you had very, very complex selectors, which of course also were not really reusable. This was the UI in 2012 behind that code base or behind that graph. And we started setting up a dedicated front-end team. I have to say as a background information that Trivago at that time was quite small, with around 200 people. And most of the developers and also the developers who have developed the front-end were mainly full-stack developers. With that, I would not say that a full-stack developer is bad, but in some cases, especially if you scale up applications, it might help if you have people who are a bit more concentrated on front-end and can also a bit specialize on that. We set it up the team. We did a lot of smaller facelifts for our application. We tried to create the first guidelines. And in the beginning of 2012, our graph actually looked quite better. We still had some peaks in the beginning of the style sheet, which are always bad because it can then lead that you later have to override them. But in general, you can see that the specificity really reduced to an average below 100. This was the UI, how it looked like then in the beginning of 2012. But the graph was better, but we had severe issues with our application, which I would like to show to you now. The first one that we built, a small Frankenstein with sprites or icons. You might know that at that time, SVG was not that widely supported, so we used still an image sprite, and what we have created was that. So it's a huge, huge image sprite. Actually, there are 7 image sprites which are just combined. And you have, if you look a bit deeper, you will see that there are also a lot of redundant icons. And I remember that we tried to remove one of those icons from one of the sprite sheets. Then we released, and then we found out, oh, this was the wrong sprite, which we adapted, and we had to flush our CDN. Yeah, this was not really, really maintainable. Also, the source files were stored on local machines of designers, and so it was really hard to maintain, add, or remove icons here. And we had a lot of CSS, so basically we wrote a lot of CSS. We wrote so much CSS that there was one time when we couldn't even release anymore, because you might know that older Internet Explorer browsers have a limit in the amount of selectors they can pass. I think it's 4,096, and if it's more, then the browser will just stop rendering or parsing the CSS and applying the styles. Actually, we introduced Jet Check after we found out that some of our pages didn't work anymore in Internet Explorer 9, so we thought it might be a good idea to at least have that check. We also had a desktop-first approach, which caused a lot of work for the mobile devices, and there was a lot of load. I remember that once even the whole UI crashed, not only because of CSS and HTML, there was also other stuff involved nevertheless. And of course, if you don't have a style guide or any guidelines which people should follow, then you create the 50 shades of gray, which we had at Trivago in our code base. These are the 50 shades of gray just for font colors, which we had in our code base. I have also to say that all those graphs, and for example, also this graphic, is produced with CSS studs, which really helps to somehow give you better metrics on your front-end code. And that happens, for example, if you don't have a style guide, and people will say, oh, I wanted to have a bit more grayer than your gray or whatever. But the bad thing is that didn't not only happen with gray, it also happened with green. And we use green of somehow to generate revenue, because with green we forward, that's our call to action button, where we forward our customers to the partner sites. But we also learned the more green you have doesn't necessarily mean that you generate more revenue with that. We also already had 12 shades of orange, and I'm still not sure where we used orange at that time, but we already had 12 colors defined. Same with blue. So basically, you can see that we had this throughout all our colors. And because not having a single source of truth, not having a style guide, not having a design system, led it that we reinvented UI code all the time. As an example, that's our footer which we had on our company pages. Then we had similar footer on our members area. We had a completely different footer on a site application, which I think in that case was our hotel manager. And then we had again another footer on our main product. So in the worst case, it could happen that you somewhere clicked on our page, and with every page reload, you had a different footer. So this is already bad, but of course, now just imagine that somebody wants to change the footer and wants to add whatever QR code or whatever into this footer. Then you have to integrate this not in one footer, but in the worst case, in 10 different footers, which also, of course, slows you down and leads not to more maintainability. All that led to an overly complex CSS and DOM structure, with also led to a lot of confusion in code and really scary comments. So the next slide is really actually, this is actually not fake, that's actually how it looked like. So this is one of the excerpts of our STSS files where you can basically see that after each declaration there was a comment, check why set index is so high. I love the second one, which is there are no mix-ins because it will blow up RTL. RTL are our right-to-left platform, so it could happen that if you change something here, and then a whole platform apparently blows up. And also a lot of other questions, green equals gray, and do we really need that or do we don't need that? So there was a lot of confusion. So we had some severe issues with our UI layer. So we started in the beginning of 2015, where we already have been 5 people which are dedicated to UI frontend, and we started to create the initial base of a design system. First, we added the components into Confluence, so in our knowledge, and we started to really build the base of a CSS framework. Actually, in the past, we had gained a lot of learnings how to not write your frontend. So we applied all that what we have learned. Let's shortly talk about process and integration. Because the inconsistency which we had created was of the fact that we had something which I like to call JPEG to Java task-driven development. We also developed a lot on the live system, so it actually looked like you had a Java task. Then you attached a JPEG file to it. And then the result was something like, so we had to think about how we transform the workflow. So basically going a bit away from this full stack environment and also specialize a bit and create the base of such a system. For that, we set up 2 teams which work closely together on creating this initial version of the design system. So the core digital design team, which took more care of the design principles and also more design work, while the UI UX engineering team more concentrated than on the code side, setting up the framework, talking with designers about visibility of new components, and also going a bit in designing in the browser and all those stuff. Because actually there is a lot of which is in between design and development. So CSS, HTML, JavaScript is maybe more on the development side, but nevertheless, HTML, CSS normally affects both sides, the designers as well as the developers. So we thought, what are all these topics we have to take care about? It's about usability, accessibility. Also, we have to think which JavaScript framework, about performance, integration. And so we started scaling up our team even more. And hired people who take care a bit of ownerships. For example, if we talk about accessibility, then we also talk about usability, and the person who takes ownership there also needs to know about HTML5 semantics and all that stuff. Or animations. It also goes along with usability, and so having one kind of animation set that you don't have the issue that whenever you have an animation, it's differently defined or different behaves differently. And we also had to think about how do we actually integrate that into our system. As a process for developing modular interfaces, we chose atomic design from Brad Frost, which is an approach for building modular interfaces. And also it helps you for better naming and to create a naming which designers understand, product owners understand, and developers understand. There's a short example just to show it to you. So atomic design is based on atoms, molecules, and organisms, and then templates and pages. For example, atoms could be just, in that case, the label, the input field, and the button. From that, you can then create a molecule which then combines the atoms up to an organism, which is then the whole header of the site. So we created a very, very initial version of a design system with a team and with using atomic design. First, we built that in Illustrator, so the designers started to set up that in Illustrator. It was a huge file of 500 megabytes, but nevertheless, it helped to unify the first product or do a first setup of a design system. So this was very, very easy. So we built components like form elements, buttons, tabs, icons, a grid system, typography, of course, a header and a footer, a navigation elements, so basically everything which you needed to create a simple website. And this is how it then looked like in our initial version. That's still the untouched version of PatternLab.io, also from Brad Frost, which we chose for our pattern library and for our environment. So we had created that, but now also a bit under the radar. But somehow we now had to pitch it to the company and make everybody aware that we want to do things now differently. I'm normally not at 10:17 in the office, but at that day I was. And you can see me here explaining to the people at Trivago how atomic design works, where it will help us to create a more modular interface. I also showed all those inconsistencies, errors, which I showed to you before. And then somehow we got the stake from the management that we could try out that on a first product. So this was a bit about the process. The first product which we actually chose before directly implementing that into our business critical application, the Trivago Hotel Search, we chose that. That's what we call our company pages. This is where we present our company, where you can find job offers, you can find how our business model works. And this year, actually, maybe it does not look that bad, but it was not responsive. It was a horrible mix of Bootstrap 1, 2, 3. And I always was afraid that when I went home in the evenings that the 90s would call me and ask to have the internet page back. So we thought it might be a good product, also because it was not that complex to integrate the design system. This was the first version then, which we applied on that design, on that product, and people really liked it. We started then to roll out that applications to more smaller micro-sites and products which we have in our portfolio at Trivago. And nevertheless, at that point, we then had integrated that, we had adapted some products, but we still had our main product, the Trivago Hotel Search, which was a really, really historically grown product, and somehow we had to create or build that base into our core product. So in 2015, we then had our CSS framework, and we did a really, really a large scale CSS refactoring project with 15 people involved. At that time, we were 10 people, and also 5 other people helped us. It was a really, really great project, which took 4 weeks, and we basically implemented the base, really only the base of that new system into our core product without changing the visual behavior. Just to show you what we did and what has changed, so the old CSS core was built on reset CSS. The new system on normalize, content box was replaced with border box. We moved to a mobile-first approach, which caused us to rewrite basically all media queries. Also, we put the media queries inline and not having them in separate files. We removed the image sprites and went to embedded SVGs. And we applied some methodologies which help you to scale up your front-end code, especially your CSS code, much better, which is inverse triangle CSS, a block element modifier, which is a naming convention, and object-oriented CSS to help you to reuse classes way better. Also, we moved away from Aesthetic, which is the build process, which is integrated in Symfony, which is a PHP framework, which we use at Trivago. And we basically moved our whole front-end build stack to Node, which also allowed us to first introduce post CSS and plugins to post-process our CSS. So as a reference, again, the graph, how it looked like before the refactoring. And now you will see in the next slide how it actually looked after the refactoring. You can see that all those peaks in the beginning were removed, and everything after that was basically refactored without changing the visual behavior of the site. So from that point on, we had a CSS framework. We really need stable and solid CSS framework. Nevertheless, we still had done this refactoring, which again only removed or optimized the CSS base, but it didn't change anything to the visual behavior. That's our business critical element, which we call our item element. So if you search for a hotel on Trivago, you will get a list of hotels. And this is the element which we then thought, okay, now let's tackle a business critical component on our side. So we had integrated the new code base, but especially in such a large-scale environment, you would never ever release something or rebuild something or change the layout of something without actually tested. So then we started to actually rebuild this component. And this is the first time at Trivago that we introduced the design sprint. We really applied everything which we have learned. We built this new element on atomic design. We prototyped it inside the pattern library. We went into meetings, discussed, and really a really close collaboration between designers, product owners, and developers. And we committed on something which then looked like that, which we then put live in a very, very short time frame. So you can also see that the content structure changed here. So on the left side, you have the focus on the content access, on the right side, on the prices. We released that, and this was also the first time when we basically were able to show to the company that all that what we have invested actually pays off. So what you can see here in the slide, if you see in the last line, you will see 5, which means that the first initial version of that relaunch went live with 5%. So we were also very careful because it can impact conversion, and as you can see, the numbers on the right are the conversion rates. So when we released it, the other number here, the 11, are the days. So we had it live for 11 days, and the conversion was -8 and -6. So really, really, really bad. But because we were so fast and we had now a modular system, we were really able to really, really fast iterate on that. And then you can see that we put the next version on with 3 days, 5 days, and so on. So basically, in a very, very short time frame, we were able to iterate that element very, very fast until we had a neutral conversion. And this has actually a very, very high impact on our development speed. So then we moved over to the other components and started to rebuild more components. For example, our header, or what the other thing is, what we call our item list control, which is above our search result list, and where you can filter and share stuff and also have the map access. We also rebuilt then some sub-applications which belong to the Trivago Hotel Search. That's what we call our member area, where we can favorite hotels and later can also look into that and log in. So that was now a bit about components. Now I would like to show you what we did to our asset. I already mentioned that there was this huge image sprite which we had in 2015. And now I would like to show you how it actually looked like in code. So here you can see that I highlighted the stars below the hotel name, which were an image sprite, and this was the code which we have used for that. So I don't have to talk so much. You basically see that the margin white for pixels is overwritten, which is margin for white for pixels, and yeah, this was really not. It also continued. So basically, this was two pages of style inspector, which was needed to. For this image sprite, which was again that. After the refactoring, we had actually embedded SVG, which only used that amount of code. And then we moved even a few weeks later to a complete inline SVG approach, as we also dropped support for older Internet Explorer at that time. So nowadays, we have not this image sprite anymore. We have a clean SVG library, which is in Git. So if we want to change an icon, we don't have to search for the sprite on a local PC. So it's everything in Git with a version control, with a history, so that we actually can see that. We also provided, it's still an MVP, we also provided a view for those icons for our designers so that they actually can search and actually know or find those icons and can reuse them in their mockups. This was a bit about assets. And we also had these issues with the shades of gray, blue, whatever, so basically every color. So we also created a new color palette, which is also accessible. And at that time, it was not allowed anymore to grab the color code from a JPEG file, also because our process has changed. I did this, I think, a few weeks ago. So you can see in 2015, there were 60 unique colors, which we have now reduced to 28. So basically more than 50%. Of course, we also had to put some effort into documentation and into a code style guide. For STSS, we use ZustDoc, which is kind of the same which JSDoc does for JavaScript. So we basically document our design system variables here. These are the variables which we used until a week ago for right to left layout. We also moved that now to PostCSS. So this also helps then people in other offices to basically understand a bit better and avoid that they use custom values. We integrated StyleLint, which is a really, really good STSS linter, which is also very customizable, to also help new people who jump in to follow those guidelines, because you make it very hard for them if you create a design system and you don't have a proper documentation. So you can, for example, set up some rules. You can basically avoid that people use the units they most like. So you can here have a whitelist here of units which are allowed. We also forced with that check that the background color and the font size always has a variable assigned. And this is automatically triggered if you do your pull request. And this is just helps people to follow the guidelines and make the interface consistent, because it's also not that people do that unintentionally. It can just happen if it's not properly documented. We also did a lot of effort, put a lot of effort into template documentation and created our own standard Twig doc. Twig is bundled with Symfony, so it's still our main template language. Also, we are now going a bit more into client-side rendering, but this is still what is widely used at Trivago. You can now see here again is this pattern library, which is nowadays also very much customized. Nevertheless, we have to work a bit on the layout because the designers don't really like that so much at the moment. But nevertheless, you can basically see you have your primary button, then you have Twig doc, which is written inside the Twig file on the top, and then the parser reads it out and puts the information into the pattern library so that you actually can see which variables are used or which parameters can I pass into this pattern. So this was a bit about documentation. And the last part of my presentation is a bit about what went wrong and why. In the beginning, which I showed to you with the core digital design team and the UI UX engineering team, we basically had a very centralized approach for building the system. It worked very well for the refactoring as well for the initial version, but it did not really scale, especially because also of acceptance, and it was also very hard for us to understand. If you build something in kind of isolation without people really involved, then it happens something, that you build a system for them without knowing their needs, and then you basically ask them to use it, and then you have, of course, also some resistance, because you might not have thought about their needs. So nowadays, we have still a centralized team which takes ownership of the guidelines and tries to coordinate that a bit better, but we actively asking people to contribute. So basically in the feature teams, people are contributing to the system and also challenge the system and give us hints what works for them, what doesn't work. And so at the end, we can now say that we built a design system together and everybody can use it. Also something which went wrong. I just found a CSS class and thought, oh, why is this in here? Let's remove it. Famous last word. I did that, and 10 minutes later, half of the company was standing behind my desk and was complaining. They were right, because actually 97% used this deprecated class, and only 3%, I think this was my code I have written, used the class which actually should have been used. This was also the moment when we thought, okay, now we have somehow to stop also with this rebuilding and put the effort into documentation, which I have shown to you before. The scope, is the scope too big? In the beginning, we were really, really passionate about this project and thought we somehow can create a design system which can integrate it in every of our applications. I have to say that all of our applications are different. So there are mostly not two applications which follow the same front-end stack, and also on back-end side there might be some differences. So I just wrote or painted that on a whiteboard. And everybody was super confused when I showed that to them. Actually, when I see it nowadays, I'm also confused what that means. So I went over to my digital design team and asked them whether they can make it a bit, or simplify that a bit so that people actually can understand that, and they came up with that. So a very simplistic version, which actually also people could understand what we actually were searching for. As said, all those applications on the right, it could be a WordPress, a Jekyll, or our Trivago Hotel Search, which is running on a Symfony, and we thought we maybe can create something which works for all those applications. That did not really work properly for all applications. So at one time, we decided, okay, we have to see what works for areas of product and what not. So we scoped it a bit. Here's a visualization, again, with the help of designers, on how we achieved that with our admin tools. So we have at Trivago also, I think, 18 to 19 internal tools, which for our metrics and other stuff, which were also completely inconsistent. And the important part here is the Pattern Lab loader. So we created a Symfony bundle, which automatically grabs the CSS as well as the templates for those applications and automatically includes them into the applications. So nowadays, for our internal tools, we have just one package which we update with all this front-end code and can automatically integrate that into the applications and relaunch them very, very fast. So all of those 18 applications, as said, can be automatically updated with those Pattern Lab loader. And we are nearly finished with our SCSS components, which I would like to somehow open source maybe in 2017. As said, we are still working a bit on a more client-side driven components, which are very, very complex in our application, but that's something where we are on. One learning which we also had was about managing dependencies or how to set up and split it up in packages. In the beginning, Daisy and Twivy, I'm not that good at naming, that's our pattern library repository, and in the beginning we had copy and paste at large scale process, so basically people somehow copy and pasted that out of the system, which worked a bit because we work very close together, but at the end, of course, that's something which doesn't really scale properly. So we moved that out into a package. So we moved all the CSS, the template, JavaScript, whatever, from this repository inside a package, which we called Trivago Core Patterns, aka TCP. And Composer then helped us to automatically integrate that into the applications. But then it happened that this package became bigger and bigger and bigger because there was basically everything, and there was all the CSS for all components, all the templates for all applications, and it became very, very big. And I can just remember that end of last year, we basically produced, I think, 5 or 4 breaking changes. So basically we released 5 major versions a day, which was also not very sustainable and didn't help. So we moved into a monorepo approach with our design system, and we introduced Learner, which helps you to have one repository and publish packages from that repository. So that's how it looks like in our Bitbucket. You can see I'm here in the in the source STSS folder, where we then have, for example, the TCP grid, which is the Trivago core patterns grid, as well as the objects. Settings, which are just the variables, so we split it up a bit. What Learner does for you is it actually helps you very much on maintaining that. So I'm here on the master branch, you can see everything is up to date, and the Learner LS will then actually show me which packages are inside this monorepo. As you can see, it lists already the new TCP SVG package, which our new icon packages, and all those other packages. We then also realized somehow that it gets a bit complicated to maintain change logs in such a system. So there is something which is Commitizen, which helps you to automatically or write better commit messages, and it has also a Learner changelog adapter. So basically, if you you add your stuff and you don't commit with git commit, but you invoke that command, and then it gives you somehow a wizard. The great thing about this wizard is that it also detects which commits basically affected one of those folders. So in that case, I did a small change to the TCP grid, to our grid system, and it automatically checks, okay, you only have touched this package inside the repository, and it then helps you to create a change log, which also, a git log, which then has a suffix, and then you can basically also pass that later and create a proper change log out of that. And then you do you can release it with Learner Publish, which is here hidden between behind a script, and then this will also basically give you a wizard and helps you to have a better wizard for maintaining the versions. Learner then published all that to our internal npm enterprise. You can see you have all those packages now here, and actually we moved now away from having this this big monorepo, and then we had this big Trivago core patterns package. Learner now helps us to really specifically publish modular parts of the systems, and then actually the applications can only pick what they actually need, and this also, of course, reduced a lot of breaking changes. At the end of my presentation, I would like to give you some metrics, because all that stuff, especially because it's so long-term, it's somehow also difficult to prove whether it adds business value or how much it improves conversion. But it's not only about conversion, it also has a lot of other stuff. For example, something like that, if people come to you and say, hey, we saved 2 weeks because we used our system, then of course it's something which people have more look on, and of course every product owner is happy if he can save 2 weeks on a project, because there is already a system which fulfills their needs, and they can then save a lot of time while building the applications. Nowadays, we have 16 contributors for the system and 12 teams using it. Also 15 public applications using it, so I excluded the internal applications. And now I can show you a bit about our portfolio. So we have different applications here. On the left side, you see, on the upper left, you see our tech blocks, and below is our Trivago Hotel Search, and is a Trivago Hotel Manager, some microsites. Again, to zoom a bit in, again, this is the tech blocks and the Hotel Manager. There's a Room 5, which is also another block. These are the company pages here on the left, how they look nowadays. So from 2015 to now, we already facelifted them, I think, 5 or 6 times, which also again shows how much this actually makes our development better. And if we have some time pressure, or there's really an urgent project coming in, or we need something for a marketing campaign, we can also share that with external companies because it's documented, so you don't have to work at Trivago to somehow understand that. And this also helps to be actually faster. I'm done with my talk. Thank you for attending it.
Thank you so much, Christoph Reinhardt. Right, guess what? I think it's time for a nice, warm cup of coffee. What do you say? I'm sure you agree with me. Or even a cocktail, perhaps. So we're going to have a half an hour break. Back here once again at 4:30 for some more developers' delights. 4:30 back here on the stage.